Hey everyone, and good morning. Welcome. Thank you so much. Welcome to Warrior DNA. This morning, I'm very excited to be able to share with you something that I think is, I mean, it's hard to go past another day and not talk about the summit that just took place this week between President Trump and Chairman Kim. It's what I'm going to use as the title just because saying Kim Jong-un is very difficult. But Chairman Kim, I think there's something very, very paramount for us today to jump into. And one of the things I want you guys to see is that we've shifted up the format a little bit of Warrior DNA. Same thing that we've always done, basically bringing you relevant news and information that really directs and correlates to your personal leadership development, your corporate leadership development. What we're going to do today is I've just jumped in. I'm going to be using my computer today so I can actually see interactions. Good morning, David Kelsey, David Butler. Love that you guys are here. And so what I'm going to do today is just really open this up to more of a discussion. I've always done Warrior DNA more as a monologue, sharing information, but I really want to begin to gather information because I really believe that the news that's coming out right now, a lot of times we just go through and we get caught up in the banter of media. We got caught up in the banter of the hype of what other people are saying instead of diving deep into what is really happening. Everything that happens in the natural on this planet has a supernatural correlation. And so what we're going to be doing on Warrior DNA is helping you dissect the news topic at a time. Today's topic, obviously, we're going to talk about President Trump and Kim Jong-un. And we're going to make sure that we're looking at this because if all you're going to watch is the news, you're going to miss these five keys that I believe this one summit. Yesterday, I felt led. Hey, everyone. Welcome. Denise, welcome. Hey, my husband Larry is on. I love that. Joining us, please, once you jump in, tell us where you're coming from. Ottawa, Canada. Great. You're going to love this because I'm also going to talk about a little bit about what happened at the G7 and how that relates to us. Sometimes we do things that are really, really good for our advancement, and sometimes we make little blunders and we've got to correct them. Today, we're going to talk about five principles that this summit teaches us in how we can improve our negotiation skills, how we can improve our relationship skills, and most importantly, I think the greatest platform that we have is the platform of human interaction. It's how we get things done on this planet. And there are a lot of lessons in this summit. Yesterday I got up, I was going to work as usual and getting ready to do some writing. We're creating some new funnels. Actually, we are doing something very unique. We're gonna be, we've bought out the entire warehouse of what's left of my book, Mission Possible. We're gonna be giving that away for free. So you're gonna hear about that. But yesterday my head was all in that and I just felt led. I want, this is what was going off in my spirit. I want you to study the notes of the summit, and I want you to study the press conference because there's some valuable lessons I want my people to know. So if that's the case, don't you want to know what really happened? So you've got these two guys, and with all due respect, sometimes if you can look at this from number one, this is the first principle, look at life from a galactic perspective. When you look at life from a galactic perspective, you can get yourself out of whether you're Republican or Democrat or Unitarian or whatever you happen to be. And you can begin to see, what if you weren't just a party member? What if you were a body member of something more universally important, the body of Christ, or universally important, this universe that we represent? You know, my son right now, he and Alexi are going to nationals next week for the speech and debate tournament, NCFCA. It's a really big deal. And this year's topic in Lincoln Douglas debate is nationalism versus globalism. And it's been very interesting all year long to watch how nationalism and globalism are two very, very diverse topics. And of course, when you're in these debate tournaments, you've got to be able to negotiate on both sides. You've got to be able, if you happen to pull that you're on neg, then you have to say that nationalism or globalism is not the way to go. And if you're on AF, you have to say that globalism is the way to go. Or maybe it's the other way around. Anyhow, what they have to do is they have to know both sides of the table and they have to be able to negotiate or debate on both sides of the table. Now, it's interesting that not only is that really great for debate, obviously that's really good for your development, your speaking, your critical thinking skills, but I think there's some more important things that my kids are learning in conflict resolution, what it means to actually be able to see both sides of the table whether you're talking about an argument with your sister or whether you're talking about an argument in your marriage. Maybe somebody in your marriage has unfortunately succumbed to infidelity, and it's very, very difficult to understand both sides of the table. Well, as we look at what happened in this summit, I really believe these five principles are going to impact you in such a way that you're going to be able to go through this news. There's going to be political banter and rhetoric going on. You know, if you watch CNN, you're going to get one perspective. If you watch Fox News, you're going to get a totally different perspective. But what I want to do is I want to challenge you, don't get caught up in the weeds. Elevate to a more galactic perspective and begin to see what's really happening in the world today. Okay, let's start off number one. Number one, as I said, is have a galactic perspective. Now, I encourage you guys, share this. This is not going to be politically charged unless you go there. If you guys go there, hey, Greg, nice seeing you. If you guys go there, I'm happy to go there. That's why I'm opening it up for conversation. I love when we can have, so this next month, I'm going to have the privilege of meeting with somebody very high in the world of the Muslim world. They know very much that I'm a Christian. And so going into that, you don't go into negotiations or conversations looking to pick a fight. You don't go in saying, here's what you're doing wrong, and here's what you're doing wrong, and here's why I'm right. In other words, you don't look to be right. You give up your right to be right in order to find common ground so that you can have a more universal benefit for all. So let's just take a look at how that works. Number one, what happened in this summit, if you have a global perspective, or even better, if you have a galactic perspective, I want you to try to see what God is doing, not what Trump is doing, or what Republicans are doing, or what North Korea is doing, or you're just looking at the human rights of one country and how devastatingly horrific it is, or how politically charged another environment is, or just looking at trade deficits. I want you to look at a bigger, more galactic perspective of what is God allowing to happen in our life, and what is he saying to little old Stacy sitting in Frisco, Texas, having a conversation on Facebook Live? Why is this significant? Why is this significant to your teenage daughter? Why is what happened in that summit significant to your marriage, or the fact that you're going through divorce, or you're struggling through some things right now? It requires that you get out of the weeds, only looking at yourself, and look at a more universal or galactic perspective. Number one, every time a new president comes in, and I've made some notes today just so that I make sure I cover, because there were a lot of really good quotes in the press conference afterwards. I'm gonna utilize those, and so that we can look at whether you agree with Trump or not. This is not the point here. It's what can you extract out of the conversation that can benefit your life, your family, your business, your prosperity. If I were you, I would spend less time judging what happens in politics, whether it's, you know, what's going on in the Senate or who's running into office. And how does this apply? How is what God is allowing to take place on this wonderful stage called the world? How is that going to impact my personal dynamics, my family dynamics, my financial dynamics? If you can begin to do that, you're going to win no matter what happens. Because here's what I know. There is a God. And a God can change, our God can change anything at any time that he wants to. Right. In a blink of an eye, he could take Trump out, right? We've seen that happen throughout scripture. But why doesn't he? He's allowing things to happen because there's a bigger message he wants us to get. Number one, a galactic perspective. Now, every time a president comes into office, obviously, they've got initiatives, they've got priorities, they've got preferred outcomes that they want to see take place, and usually it means shifting the dial from the president before. Now, if it happens to be a same-party situation, sometimes you see the continuance of outcomes. But in a situation where you go from a Democratic Party to a Republican Party, there's going to be some major adjustments. Now, the temptation is to get caught up in the weeds of that, get emotional, get angry, and I don't like that party, and I don't like that president. And what happens is you lose because you're seeing things from a little perspective instead of going, okay, wait a minute, this is happening. What is being said since this is happening? Obviously, going into this summit, Trump made the statement that his number one priority was the denuclearization of North Korea. Now, not everybody had that same priority. Not everybody is sitting in the president's seat. But he had, now remember, we're not talking about somebody who is a novice in negotiations or a novice in corporate turnarounds. We're not talking about somebody who is a novice in going into a room, winning friends and influencing people. We're talking about a mastery level of negotiations. So it's important that when we as individuals, we go in and we go, well, why aren't we talking about human rights? I mean, human rights are more important. Now, in our background in business, we've had some great blessings and privileges of negotiating billion-dollar contracts and raising up companies into the hundreds of millions. I have never seen a negotiation ever, in whether it's a merger or acquisition, whether it's a negotiating on the term agreements, I've never seen a negotiation go where you just go in, you ask what you want, you get out, and you get what you want. But if you looked at the news today, what you would see is as if these news people think that Trump was supposed to go in, have a meeting, get out with human rights fixed, get out with all of our POWs and everything, and denuclearization and everything be great. The real world just didn't work that way. Negotiations don't work that way. Now, stay with me because I'm going to flip this around on how this affects your marriage, your finances, your business, and how you need to begin to negotiate life. Believe it or not, words have been given to you as a power of life and death. You've been given principles that have been, you know, I weigh on one side, I have my Bible, and on the other side, I have my technology. One represents business and one represents kingdom business. If you don't bring these two together, you will miss the principles that are taking place and everything that's going on around you. And it is marvelous. It's masterful. It's majestic. And if you allow yourself to tap into that galactic perspective, you are going to see what it is that God is actually up to. Does God care about human rights? You better believe it. But when I hear somebody say, well, if there's a God, then why does he allow bad things to happen? Because God is a master strategist. God knows how to give people opportunity to choose so that there can be a right and wrong. You know, I understand that there's Unitarianism and all of these people that are saying just everything should be right. There should be no rules. Every drug should be made legal. I've heard that conversation. And here's the thing. What you miss out on is good and bad, right and wrong, dark and light. You're never going to have that world. So when we realize that there is a right and a wrong, we can look at it and then go, okay, now how do I negotiate on behalf? I can't change the world around me unless I can effectively change the world within me. We're reading the book on one of our teams, Developing the Leader Within You. And it's really interesting. Everybody wants to lead. They want to have a positional leadership. They want to have a rank or a title. But you can't lead others unless you're effectively leading yourself. So we're going to break that down. And number two, after you have this galactic perspective that something happened at the summit that's bigger than just Korea and the United States. It's bigger than human rights or denuclearization. It's bigger than political rhetoric between Republicans and Democrats. It's bigger than what we're giving credit for. So once we grasp that, that's the first thing. I want to bring it to you. What you're going through right now in your family, in your life, in your finances, in your marriage, it's bigger than what you're giving it credit for. There's a message within the message. There's a message within the mess. And if we just go through and we constantly focus on what we didn't get or what we don't like, and we just focus on the mess, we miss the bigger message. Number one, when you have a globalistic or a galactic perspective, you're able to see things more clearly because you even get your ego out of the way. What you want, what you have to have. Well, they hurt me, so I want to hurt them. Well, they did this, and I just can't get over the fact that they're doing this, and they continue to do this, and they have these human rights issues, or they committed adultery, or they lied to me. And if you don't get past those things, you'll begin to realize you're losing ground, and you're not moving territory. Okay, so number two is something that happened this morning. We are studying a Dave Ramsey course with our kids. And actually, I'm prepping for one of the classes that's going, I homeschool. And so I'm prepping for one of the classes I'm going to be teaching Alexi in her senior year. And many of you guys know I wrote a program called Smart Money. But I want to use a curriculum, and Dave Ramsey now has a curriculum through Unbound that gives you college credits and all that. So we were watching the first video today, and it's interesting. I watched a video on Dave Ramsey when he spoke at Gateway Church. And there's five principles about how to handle your finances that I believe are very, very important for this summit and what he played out. So this, I watched this video this morning. Here's the five things that Dave Ramsey talks about when it comes to re-establishing your finances. Is number one, you've got to have a budget. So I want you to think about this, how it comes into whether you're negotiating denuclearization or whether you're negotiating putting your marriage back together or whether you're negotiating bringing someone onto your business, whether you're negotiating which school your kids are going to go to. Okay, number one, have a budget or have a plan. Okay, that means that you can't just fly by the seat of your pants and hope things happen. You've got to have a plan. I would venture to say that Donald Trump and his team had a very strategic plan for what they wanted to take place. According to all accounts, it went as planned. Now, did that mean that everybody got what they wanted in one meeting? Absolutely not. But negotiation is a process, not an event. So number one, you've got to have a plan, and you've got to be willing to work that plan. Dream big, dream denuclearization, human rights fixed, North Korea suddenly the greatest planet on the, I mean, the country on the earth. Dream big, but you got to start small. And what happens a lot of times in business is what we do is we want to be debt-free. We want to change the world. We want to have a $1 billion company, but we don't come back to the incremental small steps that are necessary in order to build that vision and be willing to give up some things later now in order to have a few things now so that you can have big things later. That is part of the art of negotiation. You see that masterfully in what took place at this summit. Is we're going to give up the talks right now. Doesn't mean that it's not important. Doesn't mean that it's not critical. Doesn't mean that they're naughty, 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 naughty. What it means is we've got to dream big, but we got to start small. We've got to find some areas in our relationship that we can agree upon. Now, here's what happens in marriage, and this is really the focus that I felt as I watched the summit reviews and as I looked through the correspondence or the notes of the actual press conference. Is this really relates to families, marriage, and your personal, interpersonal relationships. Interestingly enough, the way you scale a company is not through dollars or technologies, it's through relationships. So if you cannot effectively build relationships, and if you cannot effectively build trust in relationships, then you will not build a great company. If you cannot effectively silence naysayers and continue to build trust in relationships, you will not run a country. If you cannot effectively build small wins, we call them love units, in your marriage, you will not win back the love that you once had, especially if there's been a violation of terms. If there's been something that you've done that has violated your marriage or violated the trust with your children or violated your interpersonal relationships, you've got to dream big. I want it repaired. Everybody wants it overnight. And so you've got one spouse that's like, why can't you forgive me? And the other one going, give me some time, all right? It takes time. And I truly believe if we dissect this summit, you're going to see that is exactly what's taking place. It doesn't mean that the adultery isn't important. It means that we've got to start with something. I'm not going to keep focusing on that and focusing on that and focusing on that when it's a wedge and it's a sticking point that hurts. What I'm going to talk about is what can we agree upon? And we come back to those points of what we can agree upon, and we start with a plan. Dream big, start small. Number two, reduce debt. Obviously, if you watch the G7 summits or the after talk after them, there were some great things that happened. Great things that happened is there's discussions about how we can improve trade, how we can actually reduce the deficit in the United States. And obviously, if you're wanting to get something that benefits you and it doesn't benefit somebody else, there's going to have to be some give and take. We learned something really fast there about reducing debt that Donald Trump obviously went into that wanting to make an agreement. And I think personally, after watching the reason why he pulled out, I mean, Canadian Prime Minister, you guys know I'm dual citizen of Canada and the U.S., so I'm not coming at this like a egotistical American. I do think it was a bad mistake of Prime Minister Trudeau to leave that meeting after putting together the communique and then getting on TV and bashing Donald Trump. We already know Donald Trump has an ego. It's one of the reasons why he's powerful, and it's also one of the reasons why he has so many people that dislike him. There's not a king throughout history or the Bible that didn't have such an ego, and it was that ego that gave him the ability to have the courage to go after Goliaths. It gave him the courage to go and rebuild walls. What it gives courage to can also be the very thing that people judge the most, right? So obviously Donald Trump pulls out. He doesn't like what Trudeau says, and he's like, what, he didn't think I was going to have TVs on my plane when I was flying away from that summit? So bad mistake on the Canadian Prime Minister. He kiss and telled. He came out of the gate saying, hey, let me tell you all the reasons why we don't trust him. And what did that do? It sent the fury through another king. So now you got power against power and egos are clashing, right? So why is that important? Well, when you're repairing debt, obviously, that is what Donald Trump is trying to do. He's trying to make his campaign make sense by doing these things he promised he would do. Everybody wants and wants and wants. And what he's saying is if we've got a 70-plus trillion-dollar debt load or trade deficit, then we've got to figure out a way to make some of that money back up. How are we going to make that back up? Let's do it through steel, right? Let's do it through some of our trades. Canada doesn't buy our dairy. We're upset about that. So let's tax everybody, or let's put tariffs on everybody for things that we can make money on. Do you guys see this? If you just watch the news, all you hear is the banter, the high-level banter of what Donald Trump did or didn't do. But if you dissect into it, these are key negotiating principles for building a successful business, for building a successful marriage. Reduce debt. There's got to be a way that if you're going to reduce debt, it means you're going to have to give something up. You're going to have to probably unsettle some people. You're going to have to unsettle, I mean, in a family, if you're reducing debt, you're probably going to have to give up Java breath, right? That means your $5, $6 Starbucks coffees are probably going to have to go. Now, is that going to cause some emotions in the family? Yeah, especially if there is a really bad caffeine addiction. So if you can begin to look at, sometimes you got to give up in order to go up. When we reduce debt in marriage, what does that look like? That means reduce the things that are stressing out your relationship. If you are right now trying to rebuild your marriage and your wife is stressed out because you keep going to hang out with the guys or you won't give up that football game, is it worth your peace? Is any football game, is any golf game, is any, ladies, is any shopping, is any habit really worth the peace of your future? When you negotiate and you're looking to reduce your debt or you're looking to reduce your trade deficit, you've got to be willing to give. You've got to be willing to give some things up. So that was another thing that I thought was very interesting on how Donald Trump, his team, was selecting very specific things that we could find agreement on to say, overall, we want the United States to be stronger. Kim Jong-un obviously wants North Korea not to be so devastated financially. So people have judged this video that Donald Trump has played. What was he doing? The final video of the summit was he felt like he had already gained ground with Chairman Kim. But what was he doing? Masterfully, he was casting vision. He was showing here is what North Korea could be. Now, I'm not saying you have to do all of this, he said. I'm not saying you have to do it just like I would do it. But imagine if the same beaches that have been sending off nuclear test weapons, imagine if those same beaches were covered with hotels and opportunities for tourism. Imagine if people begin to trust your country. What could that look like for you? Well, in the same way, you've got to begin to go into the negotiations in your marriage, with your children, with your life. Don't keep telling them what to do. Begin to cast vision on what could be. What if we had a world of unity? What if on a galactic perspective, we began to, instead of fight for boundaries, we began to see like the New Testament church, where there was no Greek, no Jew, no Gentile. There was no separation. It says we are all one body. What if we loved? I mean, I know that sounds like, you know, Miss America pageant thing, like, I want world peace. But ultimately, isn't that what God says? And I don't want world peace just for this country, or I want world peace for this country. The whole New Testament was about separating all that and bringing peace that passes all understanding. Number three on that was build relationships. Then Dave Ramsey talked about investing. Obviously, all these principles are the same negotiation principles you saw throughout the summit. And then finally, give generously, give up. Now, that compared to marriage are the things that you need to be doing right now to build and rebuild your relationships. Great leaders are great at vision casting. Yes, Sheila Kelsey, they are. And when they vision cast, they help people believe beyond their status quo. Right now, the status quo of North Korea is horrible. So what is Donald Trump saying, I love everything that Chairman Kim stands for? No, he is doing what Jesus did. Now, I want to talk to you about this. Number three. So number one was have a galactic perspective. Number two is it's a negotiation. Number three is it's a process, not an event. Again, I think that sometimes we forget that everything in life is a negotiation. We come out of the room with President Trump and the G7, and unfortunately, Prime Minister Trudeau didn't realize the negotiation isn't over. It's never over. If you watched the press conference yesterday, Donald Trump knew that there was media from North Korea. He knew that Kim would still be watching. He knew the negotiation was not over. In fact, we're not looking for an event. We're looking for a long-term process of win after win after win. The same thing is in your relationships. It's not a one-and-done deal. It's a constant negotiation of giving up your right to be right and finding where you can find common ground. Now, I venture to say that some of you are in the middle of negotiations in some term, whether it's in business, whether it's in relationships, whether it's your kids are wanting to take the car this weekend, whatever it is. I want you to apply these principles. Number one, get a bigger perspective. Right now, I've got an 18-year-old, and I'm having to encourage my husband, let go a little. You don't have to know everywhere he's going. He's proven himself strong. He's a man of God. He's trustworthy. Give him, trust him right now with the liberty of saying, I trust you. Don't have to say, where are you going? Where are you doing? Who are you going to be with? What time will you be home? There comes a point in time where the relationship should have evolved into a certain level of trust. Now, if that trust is broken over and over and over again, then you've got to continue to have the constraints on that. But if there is trust being built, you've got to give trust. You've got to let go a little bit. Everybody right now is coming out of the summit on the other side going, don't trust him, don't trust him. Look what he did before. You know, he said he was going to do this in 2005, and then he started setting off nuclear bombs and blah, 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 blah. That's not how you build relationships. If there is new movement forward, now, obviously, this is a young leader. He's been in office, what now, for 7 years. He's 20-something years old when he came into office. And again, if you just continue to believe the worst in somebody, they will continue to give you what you see. But if you can see the best, you can begin to expect the best. And when you expect the best, you can begin to see change. The same is with your relationships. Everything is a negotiation, even when you leave the table. And I think that's one of the things about it being a process, not an event. If you're wanting your marriage to be flipped overnight, sorry to tell you, it's probably going to be a process. I've seen people go cold turkey on some things. Few and far between. I can believe for you that. You guys know I believe in miracles. But chances are it's actually going to be a process. Even weight loss plans are self-negotiation. Negotiation's what we want. Yes, Sheila, that's great. And it's a process. Imagine if somebody went into a weight loss program saying, I've got to have results today. And if I don't have results today, then I'm out. Well, that's the same thing we do in relationships. I want to see change today. I want to challenge you is give up your right to be right. Lay your ego down. Lay yourself. Now, if you're being abused, that's not what I'm talking about. If somebody's slapping you around, then I'm telling you, get out of that house. And if you want to repair that marriage, which I do believe in miracles, if somebody has violated your marriage and one person is having an extramarital relationship, I believe in repair, and I believe it probably is going to take time. But do I believe in turnaround? Absolutely. And I really believe that is what we're seeing on the global stage. We are seeing a country being given an opportunity for advancement, a country that poses a terrible threat to the world if somebody doesn't step in and do something about it. Now, number four is probably one of the most important things I got out of the summit, is the fact that they walked away with an agreement to stop the war games. Now, what does that mean? Stop the war games. Well, as you know, the U.S. does nuclear testing over at Guam. So that is not very far. First off, you got to understand the dynamics of the geography here. North Korea is, I think I wrote it down, actually. I think it's like 6 times smaller than the state of Texas. And I don't know. I don't know where I wrote it. And Guam is something like 222 times smaller than even North Korea. So in relative size, you need to know what size is this country. Again, get a galactic perspective. Don't just listen to what's going on in the news. Look at what's happening. You've got this very small but lethal opponent, very small but lethal threat to the world. Something in your marriage might seems very small. It's just, you know what, you know, we like to drink together, and we drink with other friends, and it's just a small thing, but you know, we probably drink too much. And it seems like a small thing, but now let's look at how that plays in the bigger picture. Drinking is expensive. So when you're drinking, you're probably over consuming. And I'm not saying you can or can't drink. This isn't about alcohol. What it is about is bad habits, little things that become lethal in your marriage, little things, little foxes that come to spoil a bigger vine. So let's just say, and you're going out, now all of a sudden you're going out with friends that drink a lot, and it's getting more and more expensive. So now it's starting to affect your finances. Well, now your finances are being affected. You're getting debt racking up. The debt is racking up. Now it's causing stress in your relationship. The stress in your relationship is causing stress on your sex life. Now you don't want to have sex with each other anymore. Now your emotions are all involved. Now you don't think you're pretty anymore. Now blah, 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 blah. And it's like this huge snowball. That's what happens when you allow a little threat, a little cancer, a little thing to continue to grow. And if you only have, well, war is the only option, then what's going to happen is you're going to have a lot of carnage. What we see President Trump doing is looking at what seems to be a small geography space that has huge monumental implications to a global perspective and what that can mean. So when we look at this and we say stop the war games, giving up war games, the war games is US being willing to say, we're not going to continue doing that in that country that is right next door to you. So what that's saying is we're going to give something up in order to create some security with North Korea to show you that we care about you. Now, there's other people that say, why do you care about a country that's all involved in human, you know, trafficking and all involved in horrible human rights situations and blah, blah, blah. Again, it's all a negotiation. And if you only look at the weeds, you don't look at the bigger perspective. How do we negotiate ourselves out of these horrible threats in our relationships, these horrible threats in our kids, these horrible threats? How do we negotiate out of where we're at? We've got to have a plan. We've got to work the plan. We've got to know that the plan is not going to happen overnight. It's going to take time. D is the biggest war game we play in our relationships. What is D? It's when you, now here's what's interesting, is in that summit, the war games that take place are in Guam, right? Now Guam is kind of in the living room of North Korea. So North Korea is monitoring what activity is going on there with these war games, right? It's not war games. It's threats is what it is. It's bullying. It's the same thing that happens in your marriage when you throw around the D word, divorce, and your kids are sitting in the living room and you don't think it matters to them? You don't think they know the stress? You don't think they hear those bombs going off in the bedroom? You don't think they understand that things are volatile? And stop the war games. Stop. Never let that D word come out of your mouth unless you want to. You say, let there be light, there will be light. You say divorce, there will be divorce. And these are the games that people play, and they do it because they want to show strength and they want to show dominance, and it's their ego showing out. And all it does is cause fear. And fear is the precipice of suffering. And so if you really want to rebuild your relationships, if you really want to love your children, if you really want to rebuild the nations in your home, then stop the war games. And that's another strategy there, whether you like them or not, whether you like it or not, there's principles here that if you dive in to all of these natural, supernatural correlations that are playing on the world stage, you can begin to extract information that plays out in your life. Okay, number five, and this is the final thing, is patience. Patience. It's such a tough one because it requires space. And space is uncomfortable because we always like to be talking. We always like to be being heard. We want everybody, you know, I think of it right now, my kids are teenagers, and oftentimes I have to stop them and I say, are you listening or are you waiting to talk? Because there's a difference. As a life coach for, you know, 30 years now, you aren't just a good communicator. Really what you are as a coach is you're a listener. And if you listen effectively, you don't have to say as much in order to get into someone's heart. What you say is just more impactful. Patience requires you looking at the bigger plan of where you want to head. So let's say you're wanting to rebuild your marriage. Patience is a virtue that you must learn in order for that to be effective. You're going to have to give up your right to be right. You're going to have to trust when you don't want to trust, especially if you've been violated. You're going to have to pray when you want to scream. That's why I encourage everyone, be filled with the Spirit, because sometimes you don't know how to pray in English. That's when you pray in the Spirit. I have to tell you, I live my life praying in the Spirit. I know that's probably like dropping the big HS bomb on you, Holy Spirit bomb, but that is my secret sauce. Is there are seasons of my life where, man, I'm cranking along and it's like my talents and my giftings and boom, boom, boom. It's like, I got this. And then there's times where God just lets it all settle so that I have to lean on him completely. And in those times, it should be in both, but so many times in those great times, we don't need him anymore. And that's why you'll always see, I think Dave Ramsey said 78% over the course of 10 years, 78% of everyone who has monumental blessing taking place, 78% of them are going to lose it. Why? I don't believe that's just because of bad decisions. I believe that's cyclical because there's war and there's peace. There's laughter and there's tears. There's light and there's darkness. There's breathing in and breathing out. God is an ever-evolving experience. Having a relationship with God is an ever-evolving experience. Why would it be any different with your relationship? There's going to be times where you look at that person and you think, man, I did good. And then there's going to be times you look at them and go, what the hell was I thinking? There's going to be times when you are just looking at your kids and thinking, man, it is awesome. And then there's going to be times you're like going, oh my God, I screwed them up, right? But patience, if you can work through the patience thing, I really believe that you're going to begin to negotiate differently. Instead of going for the jugular when you're ministering to people, just step back and be patient. We were talking last night, we had a group of people over and we were talking about sharing their faith. And one person was talking about how they were talking to somebody who was a unit. I think I'm using the word earlier, I said Unitarian, but that is actually a religion. And there's actually a party right now. See if anybody knows it. There's a political party that it's not Unitarianism. That is the religion we were talking about last night. There's a party that believes everything should be legal. It's I'm not sure what it is. Somebody tell me if you guys know what it is. Look it up. Somebody look it up for me. Anyhow, she was talking to somebody that is Unitarian, and that's somebody who kind of believes in all multiple religions and things like that. And instead of going for the jugular, over time she's learned patience. It's a process. You don't have to. I mean, there's times where you need to go and pull somebody out of a fire, and you need to pull them out of the house because you can sense that. But then there's other times where you just have to build libertarianism. Thank you, Denise Garrett. That's the word I was looking for a while ago. I think maybe I used it differently. Libertarianism is the political party that is very big in millennials that is all about just make everything legal. Okay, Unitarianism or Unitarian is a religion, and that's what we were talking about. And you've got to be patient. When people don't believe what you believe, you've got to have patience in the process. I'm going to quote something here that Donald Trump said in the press conference. He said, anyone can make war, but the courageous make peace. And I really believe this is one of probably the biggest quote and the most important quote as it relates to having that galactic perspective. Anyone can make war. Anybody can say, you did this wrong, and you're doing this wrong, and you're doing that wrong, and here's all the reasons why I should leave you, and here's all the reasons why, you know, I should ground you. Anybody can make war. Anybody, a two-year-old throwing a temper tantrum, can make war. But it takes a courageous man or woman of wisdom to learn how to negotiate peace. It doesn't happen overnight. So you've got to figure out, where do I start and where do I end? What is my long-term objective and what am I willing to give up incrementally in order to get there? Hey, my tennis partner's on. Hey, Mary, nice seeing you. Miss you this week. Giving my wrist a little break though, but I'm going to be back in action. So patience is number five. And when we talk about the Dave Ramsey course, compounded interest over time. You can take $100 and start at age 30. By the time you're 70, it's going to be worth over $1 million. Why? Because something small compounded over time can become something absolutely brilliant, powerful. It's the same thing with those little love units that you make over time in your marriage. Maybe it's just every day saying, I love you. Maybe it's every day, instead of getting up and being grumpy in the morning and just going off to work, maybe it's getting up and saying, hey, let's have breakfast together. And it may not feel good, but it's those little incremental units, love units, that you're compounding over time. We tell our son with his sister, you know, it takes a lot more love units in to really create great relationship, because with one disagreement, you can completely eliminate the bank. You can break the bank in one argument. That's why you got to constantly, every day, be giving it love units. How does that correspond with the summit with President Trump and Chairman Kim? These are small, incremental trust units that we're creating with North Korea. Little things that have the potential to add up to big things. Does it mean that the grievances that are taking place in North Korea were stopped? No. Does it mean that everybody got saved overnight? No. But let me tell you something even bigger. Why is this important for you as Christian business leaders? Why is it important? Because that country, North Korea, is the biggest violator in the world against Christians. So what Donald Trump is doing, whether you agree with him or not, he is an ambassador on behalf of much bigger things. Yes, human rights is very, very important. But Christian rights is even greater importance. Well, it's the equal importance. Let me just say it that way. That sounded bad. It all plays together. Let's say it that way. But in order to get that, you can't go in and say, I want everybody to become Christian overnight, and I want you to accept us for everything that we are. You can't do that. That's ignorance. What you do is you negotiate small steps along the way. Again, I'm going to say this, anyone can make war, but only the courageous can make peace. So how does this parlay into, and this is my final thing I want to share, how does this parlay into an example? You really want to know, is Donald Trump making a good decision by what took place? I just want to read you how Jesus did it, because if the press were going to go against Jesus, they would have done exactly what the Pharisees did. They would have said, wait a minute, I mean, what on earth? Why is he meeting with the tax collectors? Does he not know that with the tax collectors and hello, there is a harlot at his feet? Do we not see that? She is like the worst harlot in the entire world, and he's hanging out with her and he's having all these conversations. Obviously, he is condoning adultery and fornication and taking advantage of people. No, he wasn't. He was negotiating. He was proving a point to say, sometimes if you get your head out of the weeds and have a galactic perspective of love, of what we're trying to build in the body of Christ, you'll see things a little different. The calling of Matthew. Now, where was Matthew when, do you remember, Jesus is putting together his cabinet, his 12 disciples. As Jesus went on from there, he saw a man named Matthew. Where was he? Sitting at the tax collector's booth, chilling out with the tax collector. Follow me. Now, Matthew, you know, we could say that he was that tax collector, or maybe he was one of many tax collectors, but we do know that Matthew was not your first pick of who you would say, man, let's just go after Matthew because he's the most religious guy on the block. No. So Matthew, sitting at the tax collector's booth, Matthew, a tax collector, follow me, Jesus said, and Matthew gets up and follows him. What was he doing? Now, obviously, Jesus was negotiating. I got a vision. What was he doing? He was playing the end video. I'm sure it wasn't just that easy, but that's what we read. But Jesus, for some reason, was casting vision to these guys that there's a better way than what you're doing. There's a better life than what you've got. That was Donald Trump playing that end video. There's a better life than human suffering. There's a better life than nothing but power. There's a better life than violation of human rights. There's a better life. Imagine if you were a country that was no longer oppressed and suppressed financially. What if you were a country? What if you were a person that could have liberties and freedom like you've never known before? What if you could be that leader, Kim Jong-un? What if you could be that leader that changes everything, that changes history and moves from being this horrible dictator into somebody who actually creates a hope and a future? That's what Jesus was saying here to Matthew. And while Jesus was having dinner at Matthew's house, get this, who comes? Matthew's crew, bunch of tax collectors and sinners. So Matthew obviously had a pretty strange crew, a motley crew of friends he was chilling out with. They came and they began to eat with Jesus and his disciples. Now, when the Pharisees saw this, when the press saw this, when the outsiders saw this, they didn't know what was going on. They didn't understand the master plan. They didn't understand the big vision. All they saw was this move by Jesus seems ridiculous. It seems selfish. It seems egotistical. How dare he put his stamp of approval on these sinners and tax collectors? But what did Jesus say? He said this. When the Pharisees saw this, they asked the disciples, why does your teacher, your president, eat with tax collectors and sinners? Why does he chill out with the worst of the worst? On hearing this, Jesus said, I got this answer. Let me answer this with myself. It is not the healthy that need a doctor, but the sick. But go and learn what this means. I desire mercy, not sacrifice. For I have not come to call the righteous, but I've come to call the sinners. In other words, it's easy to wage war, but it takes courage to build peace, to make peace. And I want to encourage you right now. You're going to have some decisions this week of what you're going to do, what you're not going to do, who you're going to be with. I intentionally wanted this to go closer to an hour today because I want to take time for you to assess the relationships in your life, to assess where you're at and say, when I look at situations like the summit, do I just quickly judge them or do I allow myself to maybe be a little more spiritual and say, God, what is the bigger picture here? What's really happening? And how can I extract information from these world issues that will apply to my life issues? When you begin to do that, you can begin to live a spirit-led life, not a media-led life or a commercial-led. Believe it or not, with all due respect and being a corporate leader and corporate executive, and most businesses really don't care about you. What they care about is their bottom line. They're not really making products because they just want you to be successful. Maybe they have that transformational aspect, but at the end of the day, it's about a transaction, right? At the end of the day, these negotiations come down. Why did he start with denuclearization and stopping the war games? Because it's about money, right? The number one way to speak to a narcissistic leader whose governance is power is through money and power, not through emotions and human rights. They could care less. That is not how you get to the heart of somebody who is a power-hungry leader. You go power to power. And so in doing that, it's hard for other people to understand. When you are in your relationship, guess what? You are not warring against flesh and blood, but against principalities and powers of darkness. When your kids show out, it might be your kid's mouth talking, but behind that is a principality, a spirit of fear, a spirit of pride, a spirit of greed, a spirit of anger or animosity, a spirit of rejection. If you can begin to see that spouse of yours, maybe it is time to forgive. Maybe you're not warring against that person you fell in love with when they were perfect. You got to see them for who they really were, but now all of a sudden you're dealing with spirits. And the only way to overcome the spirit realm is spiritually. That means that you got to pray more. That means you might have to fast and pray. Some things only come out through prayer and fasting. Sweet dear friend yesterday said that they're going through something with their spouse and their spouse is manifesting spirits. Well, how do you get rid of that? Do you just pray? Do you just hope? Do you just, you know, take an Advil? No, you have got to come at that with deliverance. And so you guys are going to see in my new book, Unleashed, I talk about all this to really equip business leaders and influencers on how to take authority, how to negotiate things in the spirit realm just as effectively as you're going to see people on the world stage negotiating in the political realm. I want to pray for you today, and I encourage you right now, wherever you're at, just begin to think about the things in your life right now that need to be renegotiated. Maybe right now your relationships need to be renegotiated. Maybe your business is suffering. You've been trying to figure out how to fix it, but you're not getting to the depth of really what's wrong. You're not getting to the depth of really what is the bigger issue. Maybe you're dealing with principalities. Maybe you've got some people in high places that you need to clean house because of what they represent and the divisiveness that they represent. And take a risk. Bring some new people in. Maybe in your marriage, you need to take a risk and trust again. Love again. And when they show out, and you know, I promise you, Kim Jong-un is probably going to go back and you're going to see reports and media is going to try to, you know, commercialize more human suffering to make it look like all of this is for naught. But it isn't. Little incremental steps can lead to monumental victories and liberty. I challenge you to do that in your relationship today. Have a bigger perspective. Know that it's a process. It's not an event. Be willing to have a plan and work that plan. Make sure that you are in your process of negotiating that. You're giving up your right to be right. Father God, I pray for everyone that is watching right now. I pray for their marriages. I pray for their homes. God, I pray today that they will begin to have the blinder removed in this life, that they don't just see things the way everybody else sees things, but they'll begin to see deeper into a prophetic realm of what's happening in the world around them. I could take any topic in the news, God, and whether it's the snake head and the guy getting bit by the snake, or whether it's the summit, or whether it's a fire that's happening in a city, or whether it's a volcano that's going off. God, everything natural has supernatural correlation. God, when we take time to discern things in the spirit, not just in the flesh, but we begin to pray. I encourage you right now to pray in the spirit. If you're somebody who is filled with the spirit and you have your spiritual language, pray in the spirit. That's the faith language where you don't know what you're praying, but you're praying to God, spirit to spirit. If you're somebody who right now you're a Christian and you don't know what to pray over your business, just begin to pray what you know to pray. Reach out, find, begin to dig deeper, peel the onion back on your faith and realize that you have been given this relationship with God, not just so that you can title yourself a Christian or so that you can go to church once a week. God has given you this, and I'm speaking to this in my prayer. God has given you this relationship so you can access the power that it comes with. God, I pray right now that we not just be a people who have a form of godliness, but deny the power that you represent. A form of godliness, we go to church, we raise our hands, we sing songs, you know, fast songs, middle tempo song, slow song, offerings, message, final prayer. We're not just in a routine, but God, we're in a relationship, that we're digging deeper, we're peeling the onion back. What's the good of having this life of faith and Christianity if it doesn't come with power to change things? God, give us negotiating power in the spirit to war against principalities, to take dominion over the things of darkness so that we can see the kingdom advanced in our businesses, in our marriages, in our life, in our families. God, I pray today for Kevin, for Kennedy, for David, for Zachary, for Denise, for Mary, for every person that's watching this now. I pray for them today, God, that they will begin to elevate their perspective and see things the way you see them, God, so that we can begin to get that bride, that spotless bride, down the aisle. She's not going to get down the aisle the way she is with her arms crossed, with attitudes, with division, with anger, animosity, a need to be right. That spotless bride's going to get down because she gets closer and closer to you, more reflective of your spirit. God, let us today reflect the fruit of the spirit. The fruit of the spirit is love, joy, peace, 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 not division, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, gentleness, long suffering. God, help us in these things. Patience, patience, God. Help us to better reflect you in everything that we say and do. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Well, this has been awesome. I've enjoyed my time with you. I do want us to, something else comes up. I'm going to continue to keep Warrior DNA on this, where we're bringing relevant news that really does affect your daily leadership development at home, at business, and in life. Message me, private message me, share this. There's going to be people that right now, they're going to get all caught up in the banter of what's going on in media. Share this with them. So let's just tweak people's perspective. It doesn't matter what side of the table you sit on. Both sides of the table, the goal, the galactic goal is, he says, I wish that my people would dwell together in unity. How are we going to do that unless we begin to get a galactic perspective, a globalistic perspective? Yes, it's important. You can't control the world around you until you've changed the world within you. That's a nationalistic perspective. Fix you, right? Fix you before you try to fix the world. Don't tell everybody else what to do. Don't go posting on everybody's feed on, you know, Donald Trump did this and Donald Trump did that. If you've got a marriage that's in shambles, shame on you. Who cast the first stone? You who without sin. So first, take care of your world. And then if you want to become the life coach of everybody else, great. But first, become a leader worth following. Make the adjustments in your life. And I truly believe that when you do that, you are going to become more influential and people are going to want what you've got. Have a great day, everybody. Share this, comment below, private message me. If you want to check out more archives, I'm going to be posting them at stacywallace.com and on my YouTube channel. Make sure you subscribe. These are going to get better. Sometimes they're going to be short. Sometimes they're going to be long. This was a long one because it's a very politically charged topic. And I really do believe it has significance when it comes to our everyday relationships and lives and how we negotiate terms moving forward. God bless everyone. Have a great day.